Just last month, addressing some of the recent cases, President Obama added homegrown threats to his administration's top national security priorities for the first time. We look at this phenomenon now with Jessica Stern, a former National Security Council staffer for President Clinton. She's been a professor at Harvard Law School and has written extensively on terrorism. And Fathali Moghaddam, a professor of psychology at Georgetown University. His latest book is called The New Global Insecurity. Jessica Stern, I'll start with you. To what extent is this a growing phenomenon? What do you see happening?
Well, actually, I think it is a growing phenomenon. Since September 11th, there have been about 50 incidents in the United States, somebody getting picked up either for an attack in the United States or abroad, about half of them in the United States. But 13 of them occurred in 2009. So we see a kind of blip, and it is quite distressing.
Professor Moghaddam, what do we know about what drives these people?
Well, the most important aspect of this, I think, is the sort of cyber jihad, the extensive reach of the electronic media, which is reaching the young people here. So that is the first aspect of it to focus on.
The internet.
Yes, the internet, and also the fact that these are mostly younger men. And we know that young men in all cultures are risk takers. And it's a matter of which direction the risk-taking takes.
Well, before we get to the internet, are there any common traits? Is there such thing as a common profile?
I don't believe there are characteristics that are going to be easily identified. The one common theme I think we can pick on is identity. These are all individuals who, in one way or another, lack a strong, robust, healthy identity. And in most cases, they are seeking that identity through connection with the jihadi network.
Professor Stern, is there a common thread that you see?
Well, actually, I think that's exactly right. One common thread that we see is the use of the internet. And another is that these are mostly youth who are seeking a kind of identity with dignity. I think that humiliation is a really important factor here. And they're trying to find a way to join a group that will give them an identity, something like why kids join gangs in other situations and other times.
And staying with you, are they then, I mean, should we think of them as committed already or amateurs, or, you know, in the parlance, wannabes? How do you, again, we're trying to, maybe we're stereotyping too much here, but how do you think about them generally?
Well, I think that while they may look like not very effective terrorists, and quite a few of them have not been very effective, I think their intentions are quite serious. And it would be possible, even with a quite rudimentary attack, to have a major economic and psychological impact on the United States. The goal of terrorism is psychological. It's to get us to overreact. And one could imagine quite a few small attacks that would have that kind of impact.
You're nodding your head here.
Yes, I completely agree. I think the aim is psychological impact. And that's why it's important for the United States to develop collective resilience here. It seems to me that we have become too jumpy. We have reacted in a knee-jerk fashion to these threats. And we need to build up a sort of Dunkirk spirit.
Which means what?
Which means that collectively, and I don't mean just as individuals, but collectively as a society, we need to become more resilient. We need to be able to react better to these kinds of threats, because the fact is they are not going to decline in the near future. Because cyber terrorism is just one aspect of the new global insecurity. It's going to increase rather than decrease in the next few decades.
Explain a little bit more about what you see in cyberspace. How does it work? These sites are all out there to be found?
Yes, they are all out there to be found. And one of the dilemmas is whether to try to shut down sites or whether it would actually be worse because they would spring up in new places. At the same time, we have to be careful that we don't limit our own freedoms when we want to limit theirs. The cyber war that is going on the one front, it's hundreds of thousands of attacks on places like the Pentagon. But on the other front, there are many, many attacks in terms of cyber jihad. So that's the front we have to take more seriously. I think we're doing very well in that war, and we don't want to overreact.
Well, Jessica Stern, you've looked at this a lot. Does the internet allows law enforcement to watch what's going on? What issues does it raise for law enforcement?
Well, there are pros and cons both for the terrorists and for law enforcement. It does enable law enforcement authorities and scholars to monitor how terrorists are thinking, how they're recruiting, who they're trying to go after. It's possible to actually converse with them, as a colleague of mine, Jarrett Brackman, does. But we cannot do what, for example, the Saudi government does. The Saudi government directly engages youth who are active in jihadi chat rooms. Our government really can't do that.
Well, Jessica Stern, just staying with you, what kind of efforts are there, if any, and I don't know how possible this is, to reach these young people who might be tempted by foreign terror groups?
Well, one thing to remember is that these are generally young men so far, and the people who are most concerned about young men, for example, joining al-Shabaab in Somalia, are their parents. Their parents are very upset about it, and they'll do anything they can to stop them. In most cases, there are a few cases where parent and child were both involved, but mostly the elders in the community and the parents are very actively involved in trying to put a stop to young men getting on a plane, going to Somalia, and joining al-Shabaab.
And a quick last thought on that.
That's an excellent point, that the community has to set the norms. At the same time, I would remind you that we try to do the same thing with problems like drugs, and we don't always succeed. That's why it's important to build up collective resilience here.
All right, Fathali Moghaddam and Jessica Stern, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.